Welcome to another show of Flip Your Switch. Today's show is very interesting. We've got a really good, solid guy on this show, a throwback from my days, a guy from the streets, spent 16 years in prison, juvie, foster care, all the similar stuff I went through. And he came out, flipped his switch around and started the martial arts and became a Kru. Kru David Crawley is his name, which means that he has a title behind that name, and he earned that title by being in the martial arts business for a long time, teaching kids anti-bullying techniques, teaching people how to survive the streets, teaching people how to up their game in the business of martial arts and in the competitive nature of martial arts. So we'll be talking to him. It'll be an interesting show. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned. My. Kru David Crawley in the hot seat. Glad you're in our studio. I just came up to your studio, your martial arts studio, plucked you out of there. You're doing a personal training, and I brought you down here. You're in the city core. Your school's in Scarborough. Yeah. Tell us about your school. Where's it at?
What's it Kingston about? Road and McAllen Avenue. Yeah. I've been in this game a long time, and I prefer private, so I don't like easy contact, and I don't like to be accessible. I find the martial arts world get a little saturated right now. So easy to walk in a gym and just sign up for 3 months or 6 months. My gym, I pick and choose who I train, when I train them, and what we're going to pay. It's that kind of simple.
So people go around picking trainers. They look for trainers that's going to give them something. And you've limited yourself, so you're not open everywhere. No. Which says to me is that you're a really sought-after trainer, that you can do that. So you have a history of this stuff. So let's talk for a minute. You had a bunch of gyms. You pointed out a bunch of gyms to me. You got out to join us. Flip Your Switch. That's what the name of the show is.
Right.
So you were in prison for a minute. Tell us what it was about, when it started, and how you got over it.
A simple story. You know, the same story as a million other cats. I'm going to tell you, they come from a broken home, the abuse, the whole nine yards. Warded a court by the time I was 13. So principally raised in the system, you know, from juvenile right to adult.
You grew up in Montreal, though.
Yeah, born in Nova Scotia, raised in Montreal. Came to Toronto when I got out of Bordeaux, and then stole a car, came to Toronto, and got
shot. So I have a lot of family members in Montreal also. So you'd have came in contact with them in prison and out of prison.
No, probably a little Burgundy and Platte, you know.
Exactly,
right,
that's the neighborhood
that's
they're
Nova
from.
Nova Scotia, for sure.
Yeah. So then you come out of jail. How much time did you do?
Well, in total, 18 years.
You mentioned that the last foray of your prison trip was for stealing a car.
Yo, no, that's what got me started. That's what got me in it. When I got out of Bordeaux, I just stole a car. I was tired of being in prison. Yeah. So I stole a car, drove to Toronto, ended up back in jail for stealing the car. So it didn't really make a difference. You know what
I mean?
So
the thing about, though, let's go back to this prison experience, because I've done 32 years in the system. Did it help you? Did it hurt you? How did it change you? Because it has an effect. You can't say that it didn't.
Well, it just gave me a different education. Growing up in the system, we just, no bullshit tolerance, you know what I mean? No games. It is what it is, and you deal with the circumstances right then and there, right?
So where did the martial arts come from? Did it come
from?
Well, I
started off when I was a kid in martial arts with boxing and taekwondo and stuff. My dad figured if I should be tough enough for his beatings, you know? Yeah. That was kind of his sick logic. But as I got older, I just followed through with boxing and stuff like that, because I always loved boxing.
And how did that help you in the prison system? Because that's discipline, learning martial arts, learning fighting, boxing. Plus, it gives you an edge when you're in jail because you have something other than other guys have. You have your weapons on you all the time, in other words.
True. I didn't have many fights in Shawbridge. I started off a little cuckoo. Yeah. You know what I mean? I did a couple of crazy little things that kind of scared kids off and just kind of left me to myself, you know? So, and I was the only one in the system not coming out. Like most of them kids were coming in and going home, you know?
What about the color dynamic? Were you the only black guy?
I was the only, French
color?
Black guy too, yeah. Right? So that kind of screwed things up. All the
when
French
I was
boys
in training
didn't
school,
like me.
It was,
you know?
Just me. And then another guy come, I put it in my book. I was like, guys, so happy to see him. We got in the fight right away.
Yeah, well, for Shawbridge more, it was French boys, natives, and one little half-breed. But it's
so okay. So that's behind you now?
Yeah.
So now you come out of jail, you hit Toronto with your stolen car, you get out of that. And then you start to do martial arts. Where did it start?
With Master Suchart. So I met this little Thai guy on Vaughan Road in Sinclair. Yeah. He was opening up a place on right beside Albert's Jamaican Foods. You know?
Yeah.
So guy just talked to me. You know, he told me my life was too rough. Kind of talked to me like a father would talk to me, even though he was like 8 years fucking older. You know. Yeah. So I just listened to what the man had to say. Told me he had a different way for me to develop and channel my anger. the way I'm too rough.
Well, he had a skill set for teaching kids. Well, now you have that skill
I
set.
Learned I that. See he it, had yeah. to, I had to teach. Yeah, I had to be learned that. I had no skills when I came out of prison to teach. I had a bad attitude. I was rough, you know. You have to grow
so
up.
So mention some of the places you have, because they're all building blocks to where you're at now. There's other. I met oh you at God. A place on
Carla
and something years ago.
Yeah, that was my biggest gym at 10,000.
When I was working out of Lana Motai.
Yeah, no. Yeah. I've had a Kingston Road kind of been a blessing to me. You know, I had a torture chamber start there. My house was first, yeah. starting off in a room.
You're training people out of your house.
Most out of guys, my room,
they
bro.
Look for a garage.
For you're real, right I turned my bedroom into a gym.
So that's truly flipping your switch. You come out of prison and you're saying, I have a skill. Yeah. I'm going to teach that skill. I have no place to teach it. I'm going to teach it in my house, man.
Yeah, I had no social skills to boot. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, fuck.
That's right. That's right. That's, you know what I mean? That prison parlance.
Yeah, yeah man. I'm talking to all these squares and stuff, right? But I didn't know how to really communicate. So I'm like, listen, man, just get your fucking shit together, bro. Put your fucking hands up. Keep your shit. What do you mean? Slap. And they were like, yo, I can't take this.
But that was my day. That was normal, though.
But that was our day. You know what I mean? I got beat up, too, when I was training. But it's the lack of discipline.
I had a trainer tell me once, man, you get this right, I'm going to cut you. And he had a straight razor in his pocket. That's how serious the training
was.
That'd
be screwed up.
That's what I like about you, man, because you're an old school, hardcore, no-nonsense bullshit trainer. Mm. People are going to come to your gym, they're going to learn. So your gym is private for that reason.
For that reason.
So you've developed a skill that now is attracting these higher end paying customers that want to learn your stuff. Yeah.
And they come in full. Like my schedule's full, you know. But it just became... Because of COVID, COVID ever taught me how I was overworking myself, you know? Like before COVID, man, I was doing Monday to Friday, 14-hour days.
You're a workaholic, yeah.
Saturdays and Sundays, I was on COVID. I'm doing Monday, Wednesday, Friday. I'm done at 6:30.
Where'd you develop that workaholic attitude? Because convicts and prisoners don't have it. They take the lazy way out, the fast way of making a buck.
I guess it's my training ethic, you know? I never need to train with nobody. I don't need no one to push me. I don't need anyone to be there to coddle me. And I don't need to be patted on my back. Yeah. You're going to put in the work? Put in the work. Then you know you can represent that.
I saw some of your shows. We'll upload a couple of clips of those in a minute. But I saw some of your shows. I even took my grandson to one of your shows.
Yeah, Ezekiel, for sure.
The place was packed. Huh? With everybody under the sun there. Everybody was happy. I could see the joy in them. Yeah. There wasn't a lot of tension. Sometimes you go to some open house gym events. There's tension in the room because they're fighting off of each other. Mm-hmm. When I seen a lot of people from a lot of different gyms in your place pulling homage, and they didn't have that tension in there.
It's a respect thing. You know, yeah. I've been in this game from the beginning of Muay Thai. So Master Suchar and I, we started this. Like, he started it, but like I'm one of his first 10. Yeah. So like, and we've stuck to true and blue with this. Like, I'm loyal to Muay Thai.
That's right. Yeah.
You get it? So like, these cats here, like, I don't really even put them in our same boat as us.
Yeah.
We're the legacy. I'm the legacy of this art for them, right?
I'm a trainer too, and I don't play games when I'm training people. I tell them, I'll train you for 1 second. You make a mistake, I'll forgive you. You make it twice, I'm going to kick you out of the gym.
Right.
That's the only way to do it if you're producing champs. And you
like,
produce.
We all
got to
get paid. We all got to get paid, but money isn't my objective. Feel me?
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Like I've had some bad boys come out of the
Welcome
gym that
the
work
gym
the hard.
Business.
Yeah, man, for real, you know. You got to be able to take some hard knocks.
When I had my gym here, a mother came to me and says, I said, how's my son? I said, your son's a really great fighter. And she goes, I can't afford to keep him here. He doesn't even have money for shoes. So I said, I'll buy him shoes if you work the door at my next event. So she agreed to do that. So that's community helping.
That's pretty
community,
cool.
And that's what you do also,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Well, I work with the kids, you know. I'm trying to develop their skills more so, not just for the fighting anymore, but just the anti-bullying, because they have it a little rougher than we had it. Exactly. Back in our days, we can just do the fist to cuffs, you know. These kids are getting banged.
Not only that, as I fought a lot of people, I had 1,000 street fights before I was probably 10 years old. And we fought in the schoolyard. Well, that's what they can't do now. There's no supervision in their fighting.
Whoa.
And all around us, there was people that supervised us in our fighting, the older guys in the community. You don't have that now. So kids go off kilter and they take it to the next degree, pick up a gun or a knife, and then they're charged with
or
an offense
just
they
jumping
didn't
in.
Want.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What do you say to kids that are in that position, that bullying position, and how to react? Because I heard you say it. You don't
well,
need a gun,
gym,
you don't need a knife.
That's what my gym's for, you know? Exactly. Those are the ones I'm looking for, man. My gym's not open for the tough guys and the already guys that think they got their shit together. I want the kids that are being bullied. Yeah. I want the kids that have some issues, low self-esteem, lacking confidence. Yeah. I want to teach them some shit, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I want to show them how they can get ripped up, man, look good, feel better, get that confidence on. Know how to slap someone side of the head if they have to slap someone with that. Yeah. I mean, I'm keeping it real.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know, like, I know there's an etiquette, but I grew up in prison, so I don't know how to break it down to people like that.
What I say, and I hear you say it, is I teach fighting. I don't teach boxing.
That's all I can teach.
And in fighting, it's all the same. Whether it's Kung Fu, Karate, Muay Thai, all martial arts, street fighting, you fight to win. Bottom line.
You fight to win, you fight to hurt.
That's right.
You know, you got to get a little bit of skilled in violence. I mean, whether you want to admit it or not, it's the truth. Whether you use that as an ego and walk around like that, that's your business. That's not how I
believe. Boxing Ontario, cautioned me at a fight because I said to my fighter, rip his liver out. They said, you can't talk like that anymore, because they're old school guys too. They know the business too. And I'm like, that's our normal nomenclature from the past. We don't want you to hurt anybody, but we want you to have the skill enough that if you have to, you can.
And you should know you can.
That's right.
Yeah. I can't hold you back all the time. You're never going to know what you're capable of doing, number one. You know, that's how the
MTO. So I came into your gym and you were training Monica Rutledge.
Yeah.
She's a cop. She's an indigenous cop from police headquarters. And this is the kind of stuff that I was listening to you tell her. So here you are teaching someone that's a cop on the streets who may need to apply this stuff.
Most definitely.
Exactly.
Well, she needs it more so than most people, because she's already in a predicament. Her job environment is a hostile
environment. She's at a high risk for mismatch for physicality.
Even with the people she works with. Like, those are probably her biggest enemies, you know, because they yell, they're racist. They're chauvinistic.
Yeah,
they're
old man house. There's still that entity.
And then they look at what she does working through the indigenous part and look at it like it doesn't matter. She's not recognized as a real cop inside the system.
That's how you see it. I'm gonna get her on that show to talk.
I see her as a real cop because she's just helping the natives, the people that no one else is helping.
Yeah, you're working with her
for sure.
And you get to know your clients this way.
And I'm helping her with her community. I do workshops with their girls that are victims of domestic violence, that are problematic with alcohol. I work with anything she asks me to do, and I'm there. So,
what would you say to a girl that right now can use your magic to get herself out of a physical situation? There's something that you could say right now to a girl, how to use your voice, how to use your fists, your feet, your knees, your attitude.
Well, I definitely teach them some tricks that way. I mean, for my girls' self-defense program, it's pretty a simple tactic. Like, at the biggest point, their element of surprise is going to be their biggest weapon, because the attacker's not going to expect them to attack. They're expecting them to coddle. You get it? And I teach my girls how to hit the throat, take out the eye, go to the groin. Like, we're talking serious things that are going to hurt a man.
That's right.
Like, hurt a man and bruise the ego a bit, you know?
So if someone grabs a girl's butt, let's say, she turns around and instead of saying, why did you do that? She just goes,
punch him in his throat.
Do your magic.
I'm sorry, man. Like, it sounds, you could have. No, she already was violated sexually, whether you want to take it there or not. Stupid.
There's nothing to talk about after
that. There's nothing. You put your paws on me. Your paws on me. I'm putting my paws on you. It doesn't matter how you feel, you know?
And that's what I teach also.
Yeah.
So yeah, if someone touches you, just turn around. And my father used to teach that. My father used to say, never hit a person when you're mad, but hit them right away to end whatever conflict that you have.
I agree with that 1,000%. Yeah. That was well put. I like that. I'm going to have to use that one.
There you go, Dad.
Oh, I like that one. Yeah, for real.
And he was a proponent of that. Mm. And he used that in this neighborhood to eradicate the crack problem that we had here. He'd walk up to guys and say, I'm going to do this, and if you don't listen, I'm going to hit you. And the talk's cheap, but, and he just would hit him. And that's what got him his notoriety, or I wouldn't say notoriety, that
recognition.
Was his recognition and fame here. For me, it would have been notoriety in the criminal aspect. For him, it was the opposite.
Right.
But you do that stuff, and I see you doing that stuff. So I see you like my father, similar Nova Scotia, tough guy, been on the streets, walking around the neighborhood, policing that neighborhood in the sense that you want everybody to get along. And if you can't get along, you want it to end really quickly.
Fast, yeah.
With as less violence as you can. But if you have to use violence,
hit hard, hit
there's
right.
a technique that you
For
can
sure.
do it.
Whether it's fighting, whether it's grappling, whether it's taking, there's elements. For me, it's equality for everybody. I don't think any man better than anybody. Yeah. I think we're all pretty equal, you know? We all a little quirky, a little different, but no man has a right to touch another man or step in his space, so.
You know what I noticed too? Boxing gyms ran different than Muay Thai. It's through my association with Lana Muay Thai that I got to understand Muay Thai. And there's an attitude in boxing gyms different than the attitude in Muay Thai gyms. The Muay Thai gyms are more community and family orientated. They have pizza nights and sleepovers and all that kind of stuff to deal with kids. When in boxing, that's more standoffish than that. Explain that to me. Explain that community of Muay Thai-ism? Or...
Well, in Thai boxing, it's cut and dry and simple. Mm-hmm. It's the more humble you are, because we know what we're doing. We're training hard. We understand our weapons. There's no need for the outside aggression. There's no need for the negative.
I'm making a point. The point I'm making is that families come. Whole families, well, big families.
Because it's not the environment where you're going to walk in and there's this cloud of anger and dirty looks. You walk in there and everyone's pretty chilled. I mean, we're not, you know, it's always the Sawadi Cup and how are you? And when you're working with the community, it makes things a little bit easier on me. It makes it easier on my students. It takes away a lot of pressure.
In amateur boxing gyms, I see that, but not in professional boxing gyms. Everybody's getting down, and as soon as the door opens, you could smell and feel the ego tension within a boxing gym.
But in that, they need that too. I mean, they need that. Some guys need to push. Tyson was like that.
Yeah, but he's an anomaly. He was different. Most of the fighters weren't like that. I've sparred with guys, literally blood was flying. And once the bell rang, bing, hey man, you want to go have a coffee at the restaurant? So it was like that.
Well, I think we still have it like that now with most athletes. It's just they're coddled a little bit more now and they're demanding a little bit more. No one's fighting from hunger and necessity.
You're a gym owner. You've had many gyms. You've been around. Is there anything you'd like to say to the Muay Thai community, other gym owners, about how we can do this post-COVID thing? Because you're going to need to work together in the post-COVID world to bring in that.
I got to be honest. I've been outside the community for quite some time now. I have mad respect for the community. But there's too many sheep in the community. Mm-hmm. I'm not a follower, right? So if there's two or three solid leaders and then the rest are sheep, you're not going to get anywhere. I've tried to work with the MTO. We've spoken on these guys here. They run the Muay Thai thing. Great people. I've trained them. But then now I'm fighting with them because they're not promoting Muay Thai the way Muay Thai should be promoted. They're not supporting it and building it the way it should be built. And it's a battle. So I do my own thing now.
Do you think that the Muay Thai down the road can lose their community glue structure if they don't?
If they're not losing it now already.
Yeah, that's a good point.
They're already, I mean, we've succumbed to 10 to 20 gyms dropping off the radar already. Mm-hmm. Other ones are feeling the pressure with COVID right now.
There's another thing, you brought up a point. Gyms are dropping off the radar. A, they can't afford the rent. The clients are too afraid to come to our gym. When I go in your gym, I see an exhaust system that's mandated now in gyms across North America to exhaust the air, because your gym, your space used to be a school for dog trimming dogs.
A vet hospital, yeah.
So you have this extraction system
already
that
there.
Would be envious of any gym in North America, already there.
Yeah, yeah.
So now once this COVID thing's abate and lessens down, I could see your gym crowded with people wanting to learn your magic, because your magic's real magic. And they're safer there in your gym than gyms that don't have that extractions, air extraction.
I agree. Plus, I have my outside patio too, so for the fresh air training.
You got that outside space.
Yeah, and that's blocked off by a gate. Let's say, you know, my gym, no gym has that. Yeah. Like, you have to ring a bell from 80 feet from my front door.
Yeah, it's not accessible to anyone that just wants to walk in through the door. Yeah.
And I'm already watching you on camera as soon as you come onto my pop room, because the bells are ringing.
Yeah, so if you're coughing, sneezing, and sweating, you're not going
to you can't get in here, dude. I'm talking to you from the camera. Take that back with you, bro.
That's right.
For real.
Yeah.
So, like, the security's high tank. Everything's... Yeah. I like it tight like that, because I don't have instructors. Yeah. I run the show by myself.
Okay, there's something... This is flip your switch. My whole thing about this whole thing is to try to tell someone like me not to be like me and suffer the pain of punishment that I suffered in the justice system. Is there anything you want to see to guys that might be like you that had your same suffering as a kid in order to avoid some of your pitfalls so they don't end up where you were? And the reason I'm saying that is because I see in your gym you're struggling through this COVID stuff, but you ain't going to jail. That's what I noticed. So talk to somebody's kids here.
Well, I'll tell them straight like this. I made choices in my life, some good, some bad. The bad ones made me pay a bad price. The good ones have made me live a better life. So you guys got to just make a choice for yourself. It all comes down to choices. You make the wrong ones, you will suffer the consequences like he and I have. Or you make the right ones and you can live a better life. That's your choice. Make what you want.
Hey, that's great, man. Thanks for being on our show. I appreciate you being here. Head up. Ow, man, that hurt. Yeah, there you go.
Shit. Almost broke my bones. All right, so like I was left off before, I was talking about choices, life choices, and every one of us have them. You understand? So being from the street, we've always done a lot of different things to resolve problems.
We have guns where you could have shot people. We have our knives where you could have just stabbed people. You have random sticks, rocks that you pick up off the ground. I have collapsibles if I want to break someone's bones. Like, these are all options. These are all choices. But if you know how to use your hands, and if your body's physically fit, and you have a better mindset because you feel healthier and stronger, these aren't going to be the choices you make. The choices you're going to make are going to be a little more smarter for you and your future. Because these ones here, the consequences are like life in prison, 10 in prison, taking someone's life and having to live with that. You know, a lot of people talk about murder, 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 but they don't understand the other side of taking a life, the conscience, you know, feeling the remorse, unless you have none, and then you're just a cold piece of shit. But at the end of our day, we're trying to make sure that we see these youths do something better. These kids right now, it's just random violence and it's crazy. They don't try to socialize, they don't try to talk. All they want to do is sell drugs, kill people. And they're killing her off, our own people. Like, these kids right now, shooting, stabbing, they hurt more bystanders than they do themselves. You feel me? So there have to be a change and have to take place at some time. So right now is the time. Worked out for me. I've made my choices because my choices could have set the path for me differently. If I have chose to stay on the street and do the things that I did right now, I'd be broke, probably homeless, and living off the streets. But I made different choices during these COVID times. I took COVID, and instead of having lemons and excuses, I made lemonade. I run my gym same way. I push, I hustle, I stay on the grind. Because the grind is what's going to get me real, keep me paid, you know, keep me where I want to be mentally and spiritually, for real. So on that tip is where I like to stay.
Thanks for watching our show. I hope you learned a lot from Kruyai David Crawley, a master martial arts person, a businessman, and someone who's been in the martial arts business for a long time, teaching anti-bullying stuff. He also works with a lot of cops, teaching them safety stuff that they need to learn in their job. And speaking about cops, he's trained this one cop that I went to police headquarters with him to see. And I think I'm going to ask that cop to be on. She's an indigenous police officer here working for Indigenous Police Services. And she also works out at Kruyai's gym, learning his magic and taking that magic to the street. Thanks for watching our show. Stay tuned for our next show. Hope you enjoyed this one.